If you, do you want shorter?
Well, whenever I get through it, I've never done it.
Okay. Okay, we're going to go ahead and grab our seats, please. We're going to go ahead and get started. Okay, next in our program is Karen Walsh. Karen is the president and CEO of the Collaborative to End Human Trafficking here in Cleveland, Ohio. This is an organization which began in 2007 in response to the need for information and action in Northeast Ohio regarding the growing problem of human trafficking. She is an attorney who has worked on behalf of young people in both federal and state courts and is a member of the Legal and Legislative Subcommittee of the Ohio Trafficking and Persons Study Commission. She is also a 2012 graduate of the FBI Citizens Academy, and she'll be speaking about our growing concerns in light of the Republican National Convention.
Good morning. And thank you for the opportunity to be here. As Maureen said, I'm with the Collaborative to End Human Trafficking, and I think it's helpful to know what that organization is if you're unfamiliar with it. It is a group of people who came together in 2007 primarily to raise awareness of this crime and then to work to connect services on behalf of those who had been subjected to the crime. Our idea was that there are trafficking victims who have been trafficked 60 years ago, 6 hours ago, because this crime isn't new, it just has a new name. So philosophically, our idea was that if we could educate all of society, then all of those systems would respond from where they stand. So teachers would be on the lookout for especially vulnerable students. ER doctors and nurses would be aware of some of the red flags when people came through the emergency room. Social workers would be more adept when they went into homes. So that's where the collaborative is coming from in terms of what we try to do. The topic that I was assigned was, or that's on the program, is increased risks and awareness due to the upcoming Republican National Convention. I took the liberty of rephrasing that question, which I think most attorneys do. If you frame the issue, you can answer the question. So I rephrased it because I think the question truly is are there increased risks and a need for heightened awareness due to the upcoming convention? So keep that question in your head as we go through this. To answer the question, I went back and I thought, well, where is Cleveland with regard to this issue? And back in 2010 and 11, the collaborative did what we called a feasibility study. And we did this study, it was about housing and services for minor victims of sex trafficking, because there was a study that had said there were less than 50 beds across the United States for minor victims of sex trafficking. And they were quoting that there were about 100,000 minors being trafficked across the United States and 300,000 more at risk. So we said, well, gee, what's going on here in Cleveland? So the collaborative worked with the Cleveland Rape Crisis Center, which was a trauma victim services organization, and Humility of Mary Housing, which was doing housing. We also worked with MSAS and Cleveland State graduate students to do this questionnaire. What we did is we did 30 interviews. We interviewed people in the fields of social service, healthcare, law enforcement, legal advocacy, judicial system, and they were both national organizations, state, as well as local organizations. What we found is that There is obviously a need for safe housing and supportive services, not just housing. It needed the supported services with it. There also, which was very surprising, at that point in time, remember we're talking about 2010-11, there was a significant lack of knowledge about human trafficking among professionals. And the idea was that when we went in to do what we thought would be a 30-minute questionnaire, and the first question was, you know, have you dealt with victims of human trafficking, we would get sort of a blank stare. And they didn't quite know how to answer. And so we would spend the 30 minutes, because we didn't want to take up too much time, what we did is then we'd spend our 30 minutes talking about what human trafficking was, and when we got to the end of it, people would say, oh yeah, we've had people like that come through. So the tremendous amount, or the lack of knowledge was very obvious. And therefore, there was a lack of a coordinated response. You know, people working together, social services, working with law enforcement, what kind of a coordinated response did we have? Because people didn't understand it, we didn't have the coordinated response, and therefore, you know, what was the continuum of services? It hadn't been identified if it existed at all. So those were our findings. So then I thought, well, if we're talking about special events, what about human trafficking and special events? And you'll have to watch the dates on these as I go backwards. There was an article in May of 2011, and when it talked about the Super Bowl, it was estimated that tens of thousands of women and minors were trafficked in the Miami area during the Super Bowl. That was one statement. Then there was another article in USA Today in 2011, and that was that the Super Bowl is the greatest show on earth, but it also has an ugly underbelly. It's commonly known as the single largest human trafficking incident in the United States. Those are pretty dramatic statements. Okay, that's 2011. Now, this is a little backwards, but it's soccer now, and we're talking about the World Cup. And there were claims that 40,000 sex workers would be trafficked into South Africa for the World Cup. And someone says it's the kind of number which has no identifiable source and no transparent methodology. So where are these numbers coming from? But in the same article, the number 40,000 is not outlandish at all in my mind, and that was said by someone from the United States Department of State. So who's counting what? What's being reported? Those are all questions. So in January of 2014, so we've moved down a little bit, they're talking now about the usual media frenzy that is, you know, an abundance of stories that the event will cause a surge in sex trafficking. And then the problem is that there's no substantiation of these claims. The rhetoric turns out to be just that. No actual data supports the notion that increased sex trafficking accompanies the Super Bowl. So that's a far cry from the articles I read you a few minutes ago. So the Super Bowl hype, they're saying, is not just unfounded. In some ways, it creates bad policy. And I think the idea, I'm not sure, is that we get all revved up over an event, and then we kind of just relax the rest of the year. Like, oh, here's a big event coming. Let's all get revved up for the Super Bowl. Let's all get revved up for a convention. Let's all get revved up, when in fact, that may or may not be the right way to go. Okay, what article? This is now, we've moved to 2016. So we're moving on. We're getting smarter. More people are getting aware. And what we found out is, what did happen during the Super Bowl 50? And according to ABC News, who interviewed an FBI official, said that there were 14 months of work before the Super Bowl, and he said that 12 pimps were arrested. Investigators made contact with 129 prostitutes. Most were arrested. Most were not arrested, but were offered services to help them get out of the life. So you can see a shift in how society is responding. 7 juveniles were rescued from sex traffickers. Notice the difference in the numbers. Okay, what about conventions? Is there any? And this is not scientific, as you can tell. This is, you know, what's the media reporting and what is society responding to? So for August 2012, notice the headline now says, Republican Democratic conventions could spur sex trafficking. That's a far cry from the first article. Tampa Bay, August of 2012, we have the founder of Shared Hope International saying that any large event that draws large crowds. So it's not confined to the Super Bowl. It's not confined to the convention. It's not confined to any of that. It's any large event. So that's 2016. However, I went backward here for a 2012 article on a convention, and so these slides are obviously out of order. There were million-dollar homes around Charlotte, and somebody understood that there would be people renting them and busing girls in and out. But according to the police, they said they've talked to agents who have hosted events like this, and they seem to indicate they don't see a huge spike in that kind of activity. So there's a, as I said, this slide is out of order. You can see the change in what's happening. Now, just last month, not even a month ago, NBC had an article that said a study takes a new look about how big events fuel U.S. sex trafficking. So it was February of 2016. The study was done by researchers at Carnegie Mellon. And what they did is they reviewed 32 million online personal ads around the time of 33 major public events in the United States and Canada since 2011. So at least we know what they're counting. They're counting ads. You know, sometimes numbers are so difficult because who's counting what, and did we count them twice or three times, or how does this go? Interesting, what they found is that while there may be an increase surrounding the Super Bowl, that other events like the Memorial Day motorcycle rally in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, and various industry conferences had a bigger impact than expected, suggesting that maybe when we put all of our resources into, you know, Super Bowl or something like that, those are misdirected. This is actually the study itself. They said in their report that their analysis highlights that human trafficking affects our country across varied locations, communities, and events, and we cannot isolate its impact to only one event per year. So it's really debunking the Super Bowl myth. And I think that has ramifications when we talk about conventions, whether it be Democratic or Republican. So Polaris, on February 5th in 2016, said it's a problem 365 days a year. And most interesting, towns and cities require long-term solutions to respond to this crime. That's the headline we ought to remember. You know, 365 days, and we require long-term solutions to respond to this crime. To tell you, to go back to what we've been doing here in Cleveland, we did have a conversation with the executive director of Polaris Project about, you know, what should Cleveland expect when a convention comes to town, a large group comes to town. That was back in November 2014. And these are some of the highlights of what he said. He said, balance your focus on labor and sex trafficking, because we need large numbers of employees to carry, you know, to respond and to be on call when there are larger numbers of people in town. So be aware that there can be labor trafficking going on, people brought in maybe just for labor purposes. And I back up, a number of years ago, there was a federal indictment and it involved three companies, I believe, out of Kansas City. But they were running labor temporary services in 14 different states. And they were going to hotels, they're going to casinos, and they're saying, you take care of your business, we'll supply your labor and no worries. Well, they were, you know, convicted and, but that was 14 states. And so labor trafficking is real. It may not get as much press. Key here, do not over-exaggerate or sensationalize the problem, because sometimes that works against the very thing we're trying to raise awareness of, and if we're not credible, then you know, we do our mission a disservice. He said, you know, it will increase, there may be an uptick, but remember, it's 365. He said, pay attention. There will be trafficking very often in hotels. So make sure that hotels are, that they're aware, whether it's the front desk, security, housekeeping, to pay attention and that type of thing, and to start early and have a working group that meets regularly. So we took that to heart, and we started what we call now Greater Cleveland's Coordinated Response, which in part addresses the findings that the feasibility found early on. What we're trying now to do is attack this issue in three ways. The first is a public relations and community awareness that we need Northeast Ohio to know that human trafficking happens here. It happens around the world, but it happens here too. And that's key. What we'd like to do is, you know, someone spoke earlier, we'd like to do a major campaign with some RTA ads and billboards. That's all a function of funding, and we're working on it. That's a work in progress. The second thing is to educate Northeast Ohio hospitality personnel. That is, to train those who are in the hotel industry, in restaurants, transportation, to recognize, what are the red flags? What am I looking at? Do I know what I'm looking at? And when I do, who do I call? You know, what do I do then? And so that we can begin to identify those who very often don't identify themselves. And the last piece is response and intervention, is that, okay, now we got the call, whether that's social service and or law enforcement, how do we work together to respond, not only to deal with the perpetrator, but to deal with the needs of the victims, so that in Cleveland, I know that what's happening is we're trying to focus that victims, if they're identified, are taken directly to the hospital. And hospitals have been working, SANE nurses and other nurses from the four major systems here have been working together to develop guidelines and protocols of how do you recognize it, what do you do, and that's a work in progress. Response and intervention is also working with focusing on one hotline that if you have an issue regarding a victim, let's call this Project STAR hotline, which is run by the Cleveland Rape Crisis Center. They become the anchor, and then if it's a minor, they may call Belfair. They may, you know, they'll get the various services that are needed. We're trying to make it as easy for the public as can be. Also, that we want law enforcement to know that when they go out on a call, if there is a human trafficking situation, that they can call Cleveland Rape Crisis Center, and someone who is trauma trained will go out, meet with the victim, so that law enforcement can do its thing and the victims have support from the earliest time that we can do that. So we're trying to coordinate this, not just for the convention. This we need to have we need it working now. We need it working yesterday. But it is a work in progress, and it will exist long after the convention. And it will grow, because then the next goal that's not on there is longer term, you know, housing, longer term housing. So, as I said, this is a work in progress. The more people understand the crime, the more people get involved. So who's working on this? Who's part of this? And to date, these are the people that have said that they, you know, believe in the goals and would be associated with it. So we can see we have social service, we have Case Western Reserve School of Law, the Cleveland Clinic, Cleveland Division of Police. I don't want to read them all to you, but there's this group, and then there's a second group. So and we only hope that that grows. So we are working on it, and it's really, if you remember anything from this, is remember the number 365. And the fact that we are in Northeast Ohio trying to put together a long-term response. That's the key. So back to our question. I changed it. And I said there are risks and a need for heightened awareness, but it's not due to the convention. It's due to the reality that this crime is taking place as we're sitting here. And we need to respond all together, because each one of us has a different role. So much so that when people say, what can I do? What the collaborative has always said is bloom where you're planted. If you're a law student, learn about it, you know, write about it, do your moot court on it, do multiple things like that. You know, if you work in a fast food restaurant, pay attention to who's going by the drive-by window. You're looking into cars every day. You know, what do you see? So the idea is, educate, you know, the more we can educate the public, the more we understand it, and as people bloom where they're planted, we will be able to put our arms around this and hopefully our arms around the victims and make a difference. So last thing I would say, if you don't have the hotline number, I would urge you to take your phone out, put the STAR hotline in your phone. It's 855-431-7827. And also, for the other number that's really key is the national hotline, because victims are often moved out of Northeast Ohio. And that's easy, because it's 888-3737-888. And it's written that way so you don't forget it. Once you say it, if you say it out loud, you won't forget it. And when we do programs for students, we always say, what's that number? And they respond, and hopefully they don't forget it. So those are my thoughts on the topic, and hopefully that's helpful. Thank you.
Thanks, Karen. We're going to open it up for questions. Just a couple things first. First, Karen brought all of us together into this coordinating response team. Most of the speakers here have done it. One really great thing I just wanted to mention that she also put together is we are now, as part of the educational response team, we're going around and training some of the hotels, not just giving them information, but actually doing training. Recently, Karen, Ryan, and then Teresa Stafford from the Rape Crisis Center. I know Christy's here, but I don't know if Teresa's here. Yeah, there she is. Went and did a training of the whole Ritz-Carlton staff. So from the management all the way down to the desk staff to those who are doing housekeeping, they actually asked us, I think, to come in. And we did a training on what to look for and all those sorts of things, which was really valuable. So it's really kind of gotten a good impetus and move forward. So I'm going to open it up to questions. I just want to ask, because we got requests from upstairs, please raise your hand and wait till you get a microphone, because they can't hear your questions unless you have a microphone. Just wait till you get the mic. If you have any questions.
All right.
Oh, there's one. Thank you.
I had a question. What could attorneys do pro bono work to help in this? I need more guidance.
I would refer you, I think, to the law clinic for a start. Also to Judge Cassidy, who works in the Cleveland Municipal Court, because there are, you know, trafficking victims have so many issues. It's not just, you know, I'm a trafficking victim. No, as Brian said, they have children. You know, they have, you know, probably housing needs. If they're foreign-born, they're going to have immigration issues. There are multiple, you know, there are so many needs that it covers a wide variety. But I think what, you know, it's beginning, and we did this a number of years ago. We tried to get a group of attorneys to meet to just talk about what do you see in trafficking, what do you see, and begin to talk about where are the needs. And I would, you know, I'm going to refer it over to Maureen in the law clinic, but that might be a very good idea. But their needs are multiple. And, you know, I would refer you to both Judge Cassidy and Maureen, because you can be almost any kind of attorney and make a difference. That either means it was really boring or, or I answered all your questions. I don't know. Thank you. Well, wait a minute. Here.
Sorry, we have one question from upstairs. What specific training is being done with local police in looking for red flags, i.e. language from victims of sexual assault or domestic violence?
I would say, like all of this, this is a work in progress. I know that there are, you know, online trainings. I know that there are trainings for that police officers can do. I know that there are conversations about broadening the training. So what I would say is we're working on it, and it's, as best I can say, it's a work in progress. And I would say, you know, the federal law was 2000. Ohio's law wasn't until 2010. This is 2016. So if we put it in a perspective, you know, we have to think generational change, because what we're doing is we're changing how people look at the crime. This is not new. We're looking at it in a new way and saying children can't be prostitutes. Child prostitution is an oxymoron. A child is being prostituted, the adult of a or the result of an adult action. That's a total flip from where we were, let's say, 10, 15 years ago. So education of law enforcement, education of medical, education of education people, cosmetologists now are being required to have training. We all need more education, and even those involved in it are learning every day. Because as victims say, this happened to me, this happened to me, you go, whoa, You know, that isn't how I saw it. So there's no one face to trafficking. And, you know, I would say it's a work in progress. Thank you.
Next, it's my pleasure to introduce Rachel Lovell and Misty Luminace. Rachel is a Ph.D. and a sociologist and methodologist. She studies gender-based violence, in particular sexual assault, human sex trafficking, and sex work. Her current research involves examining issues pertaining to unsubmitted sexual assault kits in Cuyahoga County. She is a senior research associate at the Gun Center for Violence Prevention Research and Education here at Case Western Reserve. Missy is a PhD also. She is a cultural anthropologist who studies sexuality, gender, and violence. Additionally, she researches the intersections of sex work and trafficking rhetoric and policy. Currently, she is a research associate with the Social Justice Institute of Case Western Reserve University, and they will be speaking on the unintended consequences of demand reduction efforts.
Can I have the microphone? I won't stay near the podium. Great, thank you. Thanks, Maureen, for inviting us to come and speak. I will be talking about some of our research around in-demand policies. Most of it will be, or actually all of it, two of the three types of research I'll be talking about will be looking at it from Illinois and from Chicago. And that's for two reasons. One, I moved here from Chicago. I worked at DePaul University when I was there as a methodologist. And then also because Chicago and Illinois has been doing in-demand stuff and has had laws, like Karen said, that Ohio is much more recent. Illinois started that a while back, which means as a researcher, we've had more opportunity to sort of see what are the repercussions of some of the laws. So she already introduced me. I work at the Begun Center here at Case Western, and I do research on gender-based violence. I'm a methodologist, meaning I do statistics and research methods in general. I'll let Misty introduce herself before. We're going to switch off. We're going to do a little tag team.
Hi, I'm Misty Lumine. I'm a research associate at the Social Justice Institute here at Case Western Reserve University. I'm a cultural anthropologist, and in this talk, I'm going to be helping contextualize some of the cultural things that play into in-demand policies. So I do more qualitative work. I have worked on issues in the sex industry and BDSM and gender, the intersection of gender violence and rhetoric.
Okay, great. So what we're going to move on to, so today I'm going to talk about three different studies, three different aspects of the research. All of this is available for public consumption if you want to follow up on some of the specifics. Some of it I tried to make it as approachable as possible, but if you want to look at the actual numbers, as I like to do, there's always opportunities to do that. So what we're going to be talking about, and we'll be arguing through our research, is that there's an overall theme that in-demand, and I'll talk about a little bit specifically what in-demand is. Often the policies and laws fail to account for the nuanced nature of sex work and trafficking. And as a result of that, it often has unintended consequences for the very people the laws were meant to help. And we'll talk in detail about how that is, but I want to give an overall theme of this is what I'm going to be talking about today, and I'm going to show evidence in our research to support that. So what are these unintended consequences of in-demand? First of all, in-demand is a general term of demand reduction strategies. It's basically focusing on the buying side as compared to the selling side. So I'll be talking about sex work and trafficking sort of interchangeably, knowing that there's a very big difference between sex work and trafficking. But as it relates to in-demand, that designation doesn't matter as much because we're talking about the buying side. And so the idea here is that if you decrease or reduce or get rid of people who buy, there won't be anyone to buy it, so no one will be selling it. And so they enact laws that make it much worse or harder to, and on the buying side, so that the and take it's supposed to be so it will take the emphasis off the selling side, and by sellers, you know, buying, selling, the sort of exchange. In-demand really started to take speed in Sweden in the. In the late 90s, early 2000s. Sweden was the first one to pass in-demand laws. It's often called the Swedish model, where they decriminalized the selling and criminalized the buying. Okay, so the Swedish model, the traditional Swedish model, is that it's not illegal to sell, it's illegal to buy sex. Whether, you know, not just trafficking, just sex. Many countries have done an iteration of the Swedish model, but that was really seen as being the first in-demand model. Illinois is probably one of the, in-demand Illinois is probably the most organized structure around the country around in-demand, and it's called In-Demand Illinois. And it's organized by a place in Chicago called the, called CASE, the Chicago, I always have to think, Chicago Alliance Against Sexual Exploitation. So C-A-A-S-E, not C-A-S-E like CASE Western. So, they were very organized and have also pushed very much in Illinois for in-demand laws. The difference here is that no one is proposing to decriminalize prostitution. They are only pushing for increased buying penalties, but no one is suggesting there are no laws that sort of suggesting the true Swedish model, which is decriminalizing the selling. Okay, so I will be talking about three different types of three different iterations of in-demand policies. The first one looking at stiffer legal penalties, which Ohio just passed. Shaming policies as a way to decrease demand, and sort of educational or schooling way through a John school. So the first one, so first we're going to look, I tried to make it a little light with pictures because we're talking about very dark things. And in fact, I do all of my work on very dark things like 4,800 backlog sexual assault kits and domestic violence and forced servitude. And so I have to lighten it up. Okay, so first one is through Illinois House Bill 6462, which was signed into law in 2010, and it has this very nice name of the Illinois Safe Children Act. In that law, most of the offenses were increasing the penalties for buying of minors. Okay, what actually happened with this law is that there were two separate laws in Illinois. One was for the adults and one was for juveniles, and they were separately tracked, different house bills. The ones with adults that increased the penalties for buying offenses wasn't going anywhere. And so it's sort of just, you know, sort of, they always stuck in committee. It was permanently stuck in committee. The ones for increasing penalties for minors, and so part of that act is sort of the safe harbor. You can't be arrested for prostitution if you're a minor. If you're pimping a minor, you increase it, you know, 15 years, those sorts of things. That one was going somewhere. Literally the day before the House Bill 6462 was to be signed, they added in the adult provisions to the minor provisions without people having a chance to read it, and it all got signed into law in the way that they don't teach you how laws are passed. Right? What's the conjunction junction things that they all, you know, right? Right? All the things that they say how you're supposed to do it, and then we know what actually happens in the real world, which is this last minute addition. So what they also did in this bill was they added in a monetary incentive for arresting departments by increasing the penalties for impounding cars, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. 50% of the money was to go to arresting departments, and 50% of the proceeds were going to go to NGOs. So the idea of House Bill 6462 or increasing the stiffer penalties for people who buy sex is that if you make it harder for them, they won't buy sex. Therefore, the women's lives will be better. That's sort of the theory behind the law. But that law is based on several assumptions, and this is what we'll be talking about in terms of the research. One, that buyers are men, and they are going to be charged with buying offenses. Two, that sellers are women, and they're going to be charged with selling offenses. That three, exploitative pimps are men, and they're charged with arranging offenses or pimping offenses. And four, police will incorporate this new legal philosophy and charge correctly. So the assumptions that you would have to have under a law, based upon what the theory of the law was supposed to do, would be these four things. Just to give you a little bit of background as to what it actually did. So I still have to often think about the difference between solicitation of a sexual act and soliciting for a prostitute, which sound very similar. But one is basically asking to buy and one is arranging, okay? So Illinois had these very complicated, that I'll talk about later, they have since changed it to simplify the law. But they went from a Class B misdemeanor to a Class A misdemeanor for asking to buy. And for arranging, it went from a misdemeanor to a felony, which is a big one, right? That's the arranging stuff, right? That's the pimping. So they made that now a felony. And then here's the monetary stuff. As part of that, arresting departments receive 50% of the proceeds, with fees going from $200 to $1,000 for impounding. And then NGOs, the same NGOs who worked to get the law passed, which is CASE in Illinois, C-A-A-S-E, are now getting that money. So they built in a funding structure under the law. So there's a research brief that's been out there since 2010 on these data. What we did was we looked at data from the Illinois Criminal Justice Information Authority, which is the data warehouse for the state in terms of criminal data. And we asked them for all the prostitution-related arrests over a 10-year period of time. Because what we wanted to see was who's being arrested and for what offenses. So as Maureen talked about earlier, and it's no surprise to anyone in this room, that laws already disproportionately punish the sellers, whether we're talking about traffic victims or sex workers. And because I know better than to put a bunch of numbers on a screen, if you look at your handouts, at the back of our presentation, I gave you things that you can look at in a much closer way than just trying to point out things on a screen. If you look at table one, these are all the arrests in Illinois, although the whole state, although people from downstate Illinois hate it, like Illinois is Chicago with a few other areas. We actually had data on, okay, where in Chicago or where in Illinois were the arrests, and I think it was like 90% of the arrests were in Chicago, but that's not surprising because what else is in Illinois? Springfield, apparently, but I never even went there. I never even went to the state capitol. Why would you need to go to Springfield?
Lincoln's home.
Oh, Lincoln's home. Yeah. And Chicago's a lot cooler, right? Spoken like a true Chicago person. But that's where the people are, so these are where the arrests are. So from over a 10-year period of time, there were 4,800 arrests under five core prostitution offenses. Two-thirds of those females were arrested for those. Now, people could be arrested more than once because it's at the arrest level. If you look I'm talking about buying and selling, the supply side, between that, 83% of them went to women and 17% went to men. So if you look overall, two-thirds of the arrests are for women. But if you look for the ones specifically for supply, the selling, you'll see that 83% of those went to women. Although I still think it's sort of, in some ways, we'll talk about why men are there for 17%. Again, you can look at the figure there, if you can't read it on the screen. So what we did was we just plotted the percent female. And you can see two things really appear. One, the top one is the blue one, and that's for prostitution. So about 93% on average of all the prostitution arrests are of women. The bottom are the selling offenses, okay? Those are men. So it's not surprising that less than 1% or, you know, whatever, or about 1 to 20% of the buying offenses are men. Women. So very rarely. So top offenses, women, bottom offenses are men. Here's this really weird in-between ones, right? And these are for asking to buy and for keeping a place of prostitution, sort of brothel or madam or something along those lines. But technically, anyone who lives in the house with someone who is selling sex could be charged with keeping a place of prostitution. So these are arranging or madam offenses, and you can see that they're about 50% male, 50% female. So as a sort of summary there, then 50% of the arrests for soliciting for a prostitute or arranging were for women. And if you remember, that arranging offense is now the most serious offense. It's now a felony. So about 50% of the time, you're going to felonize a woman who is supposed to be helped by the law because they're seen as being the ones that are selling and not arranging. And that's, and we'll talk about why that is. One of the reasons is because my co-author on that, he did a lot of field research with injection drug users on the west side of Chicago. And these women have been arrested, you know, a million times for prostitution. And their records are very interesting in that you'll see a whole gamut of charges, although they never changed what they did. They were always the sellers. It's just what they were charged with varies drastically, oftentimes, and what they could get charged with in terms of if they catch you in the act, they put a prostitution charge on you. If they don't catch you in the act, they'll tell you that you're arranging. The other offense in there is for keeping a place of prostitution, which is about half female as well. And so now that is now a felony offense for women. This is very important, and I think it's not talked about very often in the discussion, which is that women, and we can talk about various iterations of this, but women are often charged. Women often arrange for other women, or in general, people in sex work often arrange for each other. So, and oftentimes it's not exploitative, and I can show plenty of studies to support this, but that people in sex work in various iterations are arranging for each other. And so that's often why they're charged with arranging offenses, which are now felonies. So if we go back to the law here, so I've shown that sellers are not often charged with selling offenses, buyers are not, pimps are not charged as sort of arranging offenses, women are as well. And then we say, okay, well then the law has to assume that police will incorporate the new philosophy and correctly charge. But what we see, and it's not studied here, although I can point to you where this is, in Illinois, there were five prostitution-related offenses. They changed it to be three, basically buying, selling, and arranging. And so we had data, and we went back and we said, how many were still charged with offenses that no longer exist? And we found that a very large percentage of people were still being charged with offenses that technically didn't exist under the new statute. So we know that it takes a long time for laws to be correctly or to be applied, and this shows evidence that they are not necessarily charging correctly and they're not charging and incorporating the new philosophy. I also challenge you to look at Columbus's arrest records. Under the catch cord and all of that stuff, their police department has this philosophy that women are exploited in this, that they shouldn't be the ones that disproportionately get arrested. And I challenge all of you to go and look up what the arrest record is for even Columbus. I think there were some 1,000 prostitution-related offenses in the last year. So if they're not supposed to be arresting women, why are they still arresting women? And that's because it takes a long time and it takes a lot of work to change how all of this is done. But the laws aren't taking that into account. They're just assuming that this law will be enacted and that people will just correctly assume that. And we know that that's just not the way it works in practice. A reporter also did a study on this, and this is also online. And they went back and they said, okay, well, how many actually people are being arrested and charged with felony offenses? How many buyers? They found six. Six men out of all of Chicago were charged under the felony offense. You saw before how many people get charged a year for prostitution-related offenses. There were only six. So we know that at least at that time, as of 2012, even if the laws changed, they weren't being followed. No one was being arrested and charged under felony offenses. So all of the assumptions are then, I have data to support, all of these assumptions are not playing out as the law is meant to be. What I argue and what we argue in the paper is that in the end, it is a zero-sum game. That more money for police departments and demand-focused social services, when we focus our efforts on the buying side, it will take away resources from the supply side. So that means for women, in essence, or just all sellers. There's a large LGBT population as well who are sellers, disproportionate to their size in the population. So in a zero-sum game where there's limited resources for social services, is this really where we want to be spending all of our time and effort on men, on buyers, or we want to spend our efforts on women and the social services and or victims of sex trafficking? And I think a lot of people say, well, there's enough for both. And I would say, if there's enough for both, where's the housing? Where's housing for stuff? If there's enough for both, by all means, show me where there's all of the resources for the traffic victims are taken care of. And I think that no one could show that that's really the case. So there's also this question is, how exactly is focusing on men supposed to be helping sort of the women in this equation? There's some really great studies from YWEP, which is a Young Women Empowerment Project in Chicago. And what they did was, have you guys ever heard of a bad date list? So often organized sex workers will create what's called a bad date list. So if they're on a bad date, they will report to the other sex workers, hey, look for this car, don't go into this guy is, okay, so a bad date list. They basically did this for women aged 15 to 25 who were in YWEP, who are mostly street-based sex workers. And they asked them every time to report a bad date with a social service or somebody else who's victimizing them. And they did it over a two-year span of time. And one of the main things that they found is that law enforcement is the greatest source of victimization that they have to deal with. And if our response is to put law enforcement on them to help the problem, they are saying, but they're the ones that are harming me most. And they very sadly report how many times they are raped by law enforcement officers or forced to under, you know, duress, you have to turn on this guy to do this. And so even under the best circumstances where law enforcement really has the best intentions and are trying to work, you have to realize that they're coming from a situation where they've probably had very bad interactions with law enforcement either now or in the past. And criminology literature from the past five decades have shown that harsher legal penalties don't actually deter crime. We've had the death penalty for a long time. So in sum, when we're looking at this, I want to talk about that our simplistic understanding of what goes on is what's contributing to greater harm. And by this, women are being felonized now for selling, and they are being over-policed, and that never brings about greater support for them. It creates greater levels of engagement with the legal system. It makes them less safe. It creates greater economic insecurity. And that somehow law enforcement will just miraculously change practices without lots of training and experience isn't what's going to happen in practice. And I'm sure you're going to have questions, by the way. We're trying to save enough time so you guys can ask questions. But for now, I tried to also find a shaming pic that wasn't like a woman, you know, someone we don't want to shame. So here's a dog that we can shame. And I'll turn over to Miss Stacy.
So I'm going to talk about the second in-demand tactic, which is shaming. This is based on Rachel's work in Chicago, and I've helped her with some of the theoretical models of that. So the Chicago mugshot website, TPD in conjunction with the mayor's office, would make publicly available online for 30 days after arrest the mugshot of all individuals who have been arrested but not convicted for patronizing or soliciting for prostitution. On the website, there's a number of data that are available, including the picture, the name, age, sex, according to person's legal documentation, their home address up to the city block, the arrest location, date, and which statute they're charged under, and whether or not their car was impounded. So the purpose of this website is to end or lower demand for prostitution by shaming buyers. Started in 2005, the New York Times wrote an article about the policy. Chicago's then Mayor Daley said, "It's a terrible life, and a caring society has a responsibility to help these women turn their lives around and protect other young women from entering the profession." So here we see the gendered assumptions about who is doing the selling, why they need to be rescued, and what our responsibility is to them. So this is outside of the trafficking framework at this point. It's specifically looking at addressing these women as people that are vulnerable and just need to be rescued because prostitution is inherently exploitative. This is only one of several types of shaming policies. So talking about the unintended consequences of the website, it was pointed out that there are a significant number of transgender women who had been arrested for patronizing or soliciting for prostitution that are designated as male but appear to be presenting as women in their mugshots. The Social Science Research Center at DePaul University monitored the website and collected screenshots every 30 days to create a database with all available information. There was an unexplained absence where CPD stopped posting these pictures for about 7 months. With no information about what happened. So we have the question of transgender Johns. Three trained graduate students were taught how to code, and they coded for race, transgender status. By race, they looked at people's names and their mugshots. Transgender status was based on visual cues, such as hairstyle, makeup, jewelry, clothing, sometimes names. All three members had to agree before someone was coded as transgender or by their race, otherwise they were coded as unknown. We like to point this out because in social science, we're very big on people identifying themselves, but in these cases, it would be unethical to actually approach people and say, "Hey, I noticed you were arrested. How do you identify?" So it was a coding issue. So our hypothesis is that the transgender women that are identified in Johns in significant numbers were, if they are in fact transgender women, they would have different characteristics than cisgender males. In case you don't know, the term cisgender refers to someone that identifies as the sex that they were assigned at birth, and transgender means someone that identifies differently from the sex they were assigned at birth. So we examined the characteristics that were available on the mugshot website to assess the differences in transgender arrestees and cisgender males. So if you look at table 2 in your handouts, it gives you a list of who's being arrested. And so the supposition really is we're looking at is how transgender arrestees differ from cisgender males. They're more likely to be Black, non-Hispanic, at 93%, whereas the cisgender males are 43%. On average, they're almost 10 years younger. They are much less likely to have their car impounded. 10.5% of the arrestees were identified as transgender by the coders. And so from this data, we conclude that it is more likely that these individuals were actually sellers and not buyers. There is no research that shows that a large influx of transgender women are buying street-based sex. Also, the data shows that repeated arrests occurring within 10 years, transgender arrestees were arrested 13.6% versus 2% of cisgender male arrestees. So 80% of the transgender women were arrested. They were charged under the municipal code, street solicitation for prostitution, which does not differentiate between buying, selling, and arranging. The Illinois statutes, however, will show, if you look at the table, that solicitation of a sexual
act asking to buy, there was only one transgender identified arrestee. If you look at soliciting for a prostitute, the arranging offense that Rachel was talking about, 21 of the transgender arrestees were arrested under that statute. And that kind of goes along with what we were talking about, that sex workers often arrange for other sex workers. And for actual solicitation or patronizing a prostitute, no individuals identified as transgender were arrested for buying. So we actually think about this in terms of structural misgendering. Misgendering privileges state-identified gender, particularly on documents, over a person's self-identification via a structural practice or procedure. So we can do this interpersonally when someone identifies as transgender if we refuse to use their pronouns, if we don't use their given name, the name that they've adopted. We can do this on an interpersonal level. And this is a microaggression. This is something that happens just between people. But when it goes to the structural level, it brings up an institutional kind of harm. So it's a form of structural violence, and structural violence is defined as an avoidable impairment of fundamental human needs by a social institution or structure. And here we're pointing out that the harm that can be done to transgender individuals by having their photos posted on a website that indicates that they may have been selling sex, they can impact them in terms of housing, their safety, and it increases the stigma that they face in the community. An overwhelming proportion of transgender people have lost access to their housing because of their transgender status. So not only, even if people are incorrectly identified as selling sex, outing someone as transgender affects them directly. Because the municipal statute doesn't distinguish between buying, selling, and arranging, transgender women are overwhelmingly arrested under this statute. But because they are male according to the state on their documentation, they are perceived as Johns, and their pictures are posted on the mugshot website. So here we see where the gender assumptions come into play, that if you are identified as male, you must therefore be selling, you must therefore be buying or arranging, and therefore determine you deserve to be shamed on this website in this attempt to reduce demand. Also, I would like to point out at this point that it doesn't take into account men that are selling sex. So we know that there's a sizable number of LGBT people involved in selling sex, even in human trafficking, if boys are being trafficked. It doesn't take into account the nuance that's involved there. So where are the cisgender women? Remember, cisgender is people that identify with the sex they were assigned at birth. They don't appear on the website regardless of their charge, including arranging, but they are the majority of sex workers arrested. So 2/3 of all prostitution-related arrests. CPD and the Cook County Sheriff have adopted an in-demand philosophy, focusing efforts and resources on the demand side of sex work. And posting cisgender women's prostitution-related mugshots wouldn't present CPD and the Sheriff's Office in a favorable light. If the goal of your law is to reduce demand and to protect women, because remember Mayor Daley was talking about how women need to be saved, then posting pictures of women in a shaming context goes against the stated aims of the law. Additionally, we'd like to point out that there's harassment of transgender individuals. There's a term that's actually known as walking while trans. Police disproportionately target transgender women, often with the idea that they are selling sex. Even when they're walking their dogs, they're going to the store, transgender women are often targeted by the police. Transgender women are unlikely to compose more than 10% of the population of sex workers, but the data suggests that they're experiencing over-policing. The data offers an incomplete picture because it lacks the total number of transgender individuals arrested for prostitution-related offenses not posted online. But if we had the data on all prostitution arrests, we're likely to find that transgender individuals comprise more than 10% of all arrestees. So again, transgender individuals make up less than 10% of the sex working population, but they will be overrepresented in the number of arrests. So the effectiveness of in-demand. In-demand campaign in Illinois has focused its efforts on increasing enforcement at the state level for demand offenses. The data suggests that these efforts are ineffective or at best futile. Chicago's municipal codes don't even distinguish between buying, arranging, and selling of sex. And even if there were distinctions, as Rachel raised earlier, would the police charge individuals with the correct offense, especially considering their gender status? So in sum, shaming and interventions, the purpose of the website is to shame Johns and deter others, but those arrested are not all Johns. And another question is whether or not people even know about the shaming website. There have been instances where men have said, have been arrested, and their attorneys say, well, what we can do for you is we can take your picture off the mugshot website. And men say, my picture is on a website? Like, all of my information is available publicly? It's not even known as a shaming tactic, and therefore acts more as a punitive measure rather than a prevention. Trans individuals, transgender individuals, whether selling sex or not, are caught in the crosshairs of the shaming policy, further marginalizing and harming them. So interventions should be focused on harm reduction practices that decrease the consequences of sex work, including drug use, infectious disease, and violence faced by sex workers. This would include supportive environment, empowerment, reduced harm, and improved quality of life. And I will turn it back over to Rachel.
Okay, so we'll move fairly quickly on this one. The last one is looking at John schools. So I tried to find one that shows actually what this study found, which is that people slept through the class. It's true. Okay, so the logic of a John school, how many of you have heard of John schools? Okay, John schools are very similar to sort of like you get a ticket, you go to driver's school, okay. So the idea is that men who buy sex from women don't really know what they're doing to the women. So if we go to school and we teach them, then they won't buy it. So a typical curriculum for a John school is a Saturday class, 6 to 8 hours. The people pay for the class, the men pay for the class. And if they don't reoffend in a certain amount of time, then they get it removed from their record. In 2008 was the largest evaluation of one of the first John schools in the United States, the first offender prostitution program. It was actually funded with your tax dollars from the NIJ. And they found the study to be extremely effective in terms of reducing recidivism and cost effective. So much so that once it came out, people were sort of going, huh? My daughter does that, she's 5. She goes, huh? So if it sounds too good to be true, so a colleague of mine and I, we decided, she was an attorney and I was a researcher, so she said, I need you to look at these stats and let's see what's going on here. So that's what we did. So the first offender prostitution program, FOP, which is not a very good acronym in my opinion, began in the early 90s in San Francisco. Again, they found, and by reduced recidivism, they found that it cut it in half. And then they found that it paid for itself. So if we're talking about the zero-sum game, hey, it's paying for itself and it reduces recidivism by 50%. This study came out, and then all of a sudden, every jurisdiction started saying, we got to get one of those. Like, that is awesome. It works very well. Tell you look at some of the problems with it. And I will just talk, not in extreme research sense, but there's this thing called face validity, and it's what I teach my students at the first. On the face of it, does this make sense? Just on the surface, does it logically make sense that something would happen? A 30 to 50% reduction in recidivism from a six to eight hour program is, in research terms, the holy grail, right? How many of you work in drug courts and found anything near 50% lack of recidivism? And that's a 2-year program, right? So how does an 8-hour program reduce recidivism by 50%? In the actual study, if you can read it, which I can't very well, the authors state, it appears to violate several principles of an effective intervention that has been derived from more than 40 years of research. That's a usual red flag for researchers, by the way. And the city of San Francisco came back a year later and did their own evaluation, and they were pretty critical of it. So we knew that the 2009 one existed. And it said this, it doesn't help women, and they actually found that it's not paying for itself. So what's going on here? They also, as part of the evaluation funded from MIJ, they observed the school. And they talk about in the thing, you can find it online, that they slept, most of them slept during the school. It increasingly became full of people who couldn't speak English, and it was sort of a change in who they started to arrest. And it was only in English, and these were non-native English speakers. So if you have people sleeping through school, okay, so, and again, 6-hour program that people are sleeping through and nobody understands, how could this possibly work? How could we possibly get a 50% reduction in recidivism? Also, they did pretest protest. There, if you read that, there's a little bit of a problem, right? After you go to the school, you're like, you know what? Come to think of it, I've been thinking about sex for 6 hours, so I think, now, thank you for helping me think about that all day. So I think actually, you know what? I'm gonna buy more. Statistically, I would probably say that's not a significant change, but it's sure not, it's sure not better after a 6-hour program. And all, I'm not making this up. You can read this in the report. So, okay, so we wrote a brief that's online, and I would encourage you to read it if you want, because I had the attorney try to, we kept writing over and over again to make it as approachable as possible, because research is not approachable oftentimes. So it lacks some real face validity. Lacked face validity. But the main problem that we had with it is that every other place was starting to implement this, because there was a NIJ study that said it was effective, and it paid for itself and it reduced recidivism, so let's not adopt it. And what we argue in the paper is, like, we can't necessarily say whether John schools or not, because we didn't do the evaluation, but we can say, don't base your decision off this study, because this study does not show you what you think you want to see. So we did, we critiqued it in the here is because it's a methodological critique. We critiqued it on statistical procedures and on research procedures. I will talk briefly about the statistics, which get very complicated. But two things. One, they didn't actually study people who went through the program, because they didn't have data on that. They never kept data on who went through the program to track them over time. They instead looked at all the crime statistics in San Francisco and pulled out criminal records of people who could have been eligible. But at that time, about 200 people had been through the program, and they were looking at criminal records for all of San Francisco. The next thing that they did, they say, okay, here's this pool of people who could have been exposed to the program in San Francisco. We're going to compare that to all the people who could have gone to it in California. Right, I saw a quizzical look, right? Why would you compare people in San Francisco to your comparison group of people in California? Has anyone ever been to San Francisco? Has anyone thought that that may be different from California? Right. You're also comparing a very small inn to a very large inn, right? And there's a lot of issues with that. Like, a comparison group and a treatment group have to be similar, or similar enough to make the argument that you can compare these two. I think it's pretty easy to say you can't compare these two. Additionally, there's a statistical, for the method that they used, it logically makes sense. The two groups should be similar, and then something happens, and then they should divert if the program works, right? What you saw, actually, was that a big drop in arrests right before in San Francisco because of funding issues. They weren't doing reverse stings anymore. So the big drop happened before the intervention even got implemented. So that's an issue. I've actually had lots of conversations with the lead author. As soon as this came out, I was getting emails about, when we went round and round on the statistics, but I was still stand by these sorts of things. How many have heard of Shively? He does a lot of work in this area. So what's happening here with the recidivism rates? One, San Francisco's recidivism and arrest rates are all based on stings. They don't just do street level stuff, they do reverse stings. And so as funding decreased to do stings, so did arrest rates. And we know arrest rates are not necessarily a good representation of actual crimes being committed. And the as best case we have is that John's recidivate about 2%, and rearrest recidivism about 2%. So we also have to context, even if it was 50%, you're talking about reducing recidivism from 2 to 1%, right? Like, we're not talking about a 50% reduction in something very small. It's still a 50% reduction. It's just not very much. And the school can't isolate the impact of arrest versus the impact of the school, because arrest can serve as a big deterrent in sex work for buying, more so than perhaps actually going to the school. And it couldn't do that. And then San Francisco found that it couldn't pay for itself. What ended up happening is that people were continuing to go through the program, but it sort of got clumped into sort of more poor, more disadvantaged Johns over time through the sting stuff. And then people couldn't pay for it, but then they had to offer it, and then they couldn't pay. And so it ended up, it's not actually paying for itself. So what are some of the unintended consequences? Studies of it have since come out and sort of showed that much of the information that they provide in the stuff has very conflicting images for women. So here we're sort of supposed to be teaching. But the question I would pose is, what do you want to be teaching them? Because they talked about how diseased women are and how they're all victims, or how they're just trying to rip you off. And so even at the end of it, they're like, wait, so are the women the victims? Are they ripping me off? Are they diseased agents? Like, what's the story here? And I think you have to have, if you're going to do this, you have to have something that's going to not actually end up harming and giving these men worse images of what they started out with, even though they're still going to buy sex, apparently, from what they say. So really, what we're being taught is that really something positive, I think, sort of what's in the curriculum matters as well. This is a quote that I won't read from the paper that we write, and it's basically what much of my research is about, which is showing we, especially as it relates to in-demand, there's not, as Karen said, the number of traffic victims is way overestimated, and those numbers don't do anything to help the cause. What isn't talked about, so we sort of sensationalize it, but what isn't talked about is just the vast amount of resources that this population needs. And I hope that that's what you get from this talk today, that when we talk about this, they need the Cadillac. They need all kinds of services and resources put towards them. And if we only put it towards rescue, if we put it towards in-demand, if we just narrow our stuff to just awareness and not really providing the social services they need, we're never going to help get at the root cause, which is that these individuals have been traumatized and marginalized, and they are one of the most disadvantaged groups in society. And if we want to provide resources towards them, we've got to put our money where our mouth is and provide them the Cadillac that they need, which is not what that quote says. That's where I went at the end of the presentation. Like any good researcher, I've provided you with a bibliography of some studies. This field is notoriously horrible with research that nobody, and I would never pass a grad student if they did research like that. But I have chosen some of the better ones, and I hope, and if you know, my email is here. If you ever want research or you're looking for something, I've probably read it, and I have probably critiqued it, maybe even. I'm happy to serve as a guide to finding the good stuff and weeding out the good stuff from the bad stuff, because that's part of my job as a methodologist. I would like to say thank you very much. And I don't know how much time we have for questions, but I... Yes, sure. Oh, sorry.
Thank you very much. Great presentation. I would just like to ask, you mentioned that Sweden was the first one historically that did the John schools. What kind of research did they have on the effectiveness that everybody else, or Illinois anyway, started copying it?
Okay, so there is a lot of stuff. The Swedes, one thing they're really good at is research and data. And they also, you know, they're sort of like enemy of the state. Sort of, they track their people in a way that's scary for us, but amazing for researchers. they have done a lot of studies on the effectiveness, and it's shown sort of a mixed bag. So at the first stuff that came out after they passed the law, it showed that it decreased visible street-level sex work, street-based sex work. That happened, though, to coincide with the rise of the internet. And so the second study that they did came out that said, oh, yeah, it decreased what we saw, but we think it's going online. So it wasn't necessarily the effect of the law so much as an effect of changes in technology. And now we know almost all street work, or all even sort of even street-level sex work, street-based sex work, is often put online on Backpage, even though they're not necessarily escorts. They'll do that.
Rachel, can you just clarify, this isn't John's
school. No, this is not John's school. Okay, yeah. This is the decriminalization. Other European studies came back, and I can show you some of the studies on that. The Netherlands is one that did it. They went and studied the Swedes and said, let's see what we can do, or let's see what works. What they did find was that it didn't take it away, it just changed it. So what happened was that women had to negotiate, so the most marginalized women who still had to be on the street had less time to negotiate, had to take less money for their dates, and we're talking about trafficked or untrafficked, we're just talking about sex work in general. And it also created the sex workers were saying is more violent Johns. So the ones who would be risking getting arrested were the ones who tended to be more violent or had other issues. And so I think the complexity is that this is a very complex issue and a very complex economy. And that if you change one thing, you can't just assume it's going to go away. It's just going to change. In the same way that the war on drugs didn't take away drugs, it just changed the market behind it. And you have to anticipate that a law in and of itself won't do that. It just changes it. And are we prepared for what those changes mean? And I'll let Misty, if you have anything to add to that.
The only thing that I would add is when you look at the elasticity of the market, when you institute in-demand policies, then you're reducing the demand. The people that are already doing survival sex work, that are trading sex work for places to stay or money for drugs, that are doing street-based sex, if they don't have an option to get out, they can't get out. They simply do more work, or they involve more people in prostitution, in sex work, to support themselves. So if you don't offer any meaningful alternative, people are just working longer hours. They're trying to get other people in the household involved just so that they can support themselves.
Do you believe?
It's okay. We understand. Yeah,
I'm trying to compose my thoughts here.
Figure out how to.
Do you believe that it would be more effective in John's schools to focus more on themselves rather than on the women they are harming? And do you believe that today's very easy sex culture, where if you want to hook up, fine, hook up, doesn't matter if you know the person or not, who really cares as long as it's consensual? Do you think, first of all, that has an impact on this? And second, do you believe it would be more effective to look at their issues about why do you feel the need to solicit this person? What circumstances in your life perhaps are, you know, keeping you from having a proper relationship, an intimate relationship? Obviously, I'm not a counselor, but do you think that, you know, exploring those issues, their own personal issues, rather than, you know, these nameless, faceless women out here are being hurt and you should feel bad about it?
I'm trying to compose my response. As a researcher, I would say that that's not my bag. I would say that if you are going to have John schools, sort of, this is not the model to go after, by research-wise. I would say that I will say that I've met in my research, and Misty has as well, many women and men, but, you know, many sex workers who say, like, I have no problem selling sex for money. I'm not exploited. I want to do this. This is my body, and this is my agency. And I should be allowed to have agency over what I do.
I don't want to, like, that's not the realm of things that I necessarily want to get into, but I think to say that, you know, that all sex work is necessarily bad or that all sex work looks like human trafficking does disservice to both sex workers and trafficked victims, because then we're not giving the full extent of their lived reality. And if we just focus on sort of, I think some of the stuff in John's schools has shown that they tend to make them say that they have a sex addiction. So the sort of focus on the psychological aspect of, like, why are they buying sex? And so you must have a sex addiction if you would buy sex. And I don't think that that's the case. And what ends up happening is they're like, I have a sex addiction. And you're like, well, technically you don't really have a sex addiction. You're just buying sex, which are not one and the same thing. So I think there's too much opportunity in John's schools to start to problematize and sanitize a very complex system. And in 6 hours, you can't really get to it very well.
I would also like to add that I don't think it's necessarily the over-sexualization of our culture that's leading to this kind of thing. If you think about prostitution or sex work as dehumanizing women, but that you really need to investigate the forces of capitalism. That when you start thinking that things can be bought and sold and that everything has a price, if you have a problem with women or men or transgender individuals selling access to themselves, then what you really need to think about is the drug problem or capitalism that brings us to think of people as things. So I don't think it's necessarily more pornography or people casually hooking up, but that we can commoditize anything.
Talking like it's true academics. We got to bring in Marx or capitalism to some discussion that we have.
Okay, so I know we want to break for lunch, but I'm going to ask one more question. And I'm having trouble framing it, too, because I think we could probably talk for days about a lot of the issues you were raising. What concerns me is I don't know where your research leads, not just you, but other people who are reading it and looking at it. So, unfortunately, in Cleveland, we know all too well that police conduct toward, based on race, age, gender, all kinds of things, is horrendous, okay? There's overcharging, there's violence, there is a systemic, you know, police, prosecutor, courts problem here. It's not just about sex crimes, it's about every kind of crime. That doesn't lead us to say, well, we shouldn't have assault laws. You know, we shouldn't punish people who do this behavior because we can't rely on the system to appropriately apply the law. So that's what's worrying me. So I think to just jump to, well, we shouldn't be so focused on the buyers because we're implementing it really poorly worries me. And I just raise it sort of as a general question in terms of where do you go with this? So where does your research take you? Would you get rid of these laws? Would you rewrite these laws? None of us in here today would disagree that we need more services. Would you spend money on training police? I mean, where would you take this?
To me, law enforcement would be the, right, so that's the argument like, oh, well, we shouldn't, I'm sorry, regulate guns because, hey, criminals don't follow laws, so we shouldn't have gun stuff, or we, you know, rapists, my work in sexual, rapists aren't held accountable, so we shouldn't have rape laws. Like, in no way is any of my research suggesting that, you know, just because we shouldn't necessarily have any laws against trafficking and stuff like that. That's in no way what I want this research to say. What I hope that the bigger picture from this is that we take into account the very nuanced nature and oftentimes in human trafficking and in sex work and in looking at John's, we have a very simplistic view of what happens. Like they all have pimps. All the pictures of human trafficking all tend to be like white young girls that look a little dirty, that's sitting on a curb. Like that's not who these folks are. That's not their lived experience. And I think anyone who's working with these individuals know that their stories are very complex and that if we just paint them with as the victim brush, we're not doing them a service. However, That isn't to say that we shouldn't have certain laws against the most egregious things. I would say that this research should say we need to go back to some of these laws and see, okay, this isn't working the way that we thought it would. At least let's change the way that some of these laws are enacted. And that taking into account, for example, that people in sex work often arrange for each other, that most sex workers and even trafficked people don't have pimps. So what do we do with those individuals? And it's having the laws take into account the nuanced nature of different people's experiences and saying that you don't just have to have a pimp to be able to get certain practices or laws. New York has done some really great stuff with their prostitution court. And even then, many of the sex workers say, you know, how is this helping me? So I would say that the research should really only be about a constant refinement of what we do have, because we can't just paint it with a broad brush.
I would just like to say that I am for decriminalization of sex work in general, that I don't think the law is an appropriate way to handle people that are involved in exploitative relationships. And I understand that there are some cases, the most egregious cases, in sex trafficking cases, that the law needs to be involved in order to hold the people that are exploiting other people accountable. But that when you're looking at prostitution-related offenses, that if these people need help, if these people need services, that you shouldn't hold the possibility of a conviction charge over them in order to force them into services that they may not be interested in. We hear a lot about times about people, like victims that are brought into the system that immediately run, that they cross state lines, they don't want to testify, they don't want to be in treatment. And it makes me nervous when we talk about the solution to that being lockdown facilities. I mean, we're saying that we know better than what people, than what they say that they need. So I think that in this work, it's really important to hear the voices of victims of human trafficking, but it's also important to hear the voices of people who are affected by the laws that we are using to target human trafficking. So there are people that are being caught in the crosshairs of these laws that we've decided, well, it's not that bad if they get swept up in this as well.
We're also available during lunch. Yes, is it?
Hi. My question is about the Johns. Okay, I keep hearing about statistics about them going to class, but I don't hear the statistic about why it always have to be sex. How some of these Johns are out there because they have drug problems too, and they don't always pick up prostitutes, girls of the streets, just for sex. They pick them up sometimes because they know where to get the drugs and things at. So when they go to class, they only talk about sex, and they only say, hey, look, you got to go here about the sex. They don't test them to see if they have a drug problem. They don't put them in court like they do prostitutes or anything like that. It's only, Johns are only punished by sex.
I think that that's a very good point, that we just think of them as sort of having a universal problem for, can everyone see the quotes? That there's a lack of resources across the board, and that perhaps meeting better needs of substance abuse and mental health and all of these sorts of things, this is where our focus should be on much more the social services than the punitive law enforcement side, is what I think the research shows. But yeah, thank you for your point. That's a good point.
They'll be available during lunch for any other questions, but we're going to break for lunch now. So we're going to go ahead and come back together at 1:30. The Botanical Garden is right across the street. There is also Tinkumville, which is right across the street that way, which has lots of food available. Anything else?
Well, we had hoped for a gorgeous spring day. If you feel like walking in the cold, you can go up to Euclid.
Yeah, there's tons of, if you want to walk a couple blocks to Euclid, there's tons of things available. So we'll come back at 1:30. So again, 1:30, we'll come back.
thank you. Number one, I don't think capitalism has anything to do with it. But one of the things that we're looking at, only had to represent women.